If you have completed the tutorials on task-based fMRI studies, you are familiar with how basis functions are convolved with onset times to best fit the time series. One drawback of this method is that a single best fitting parameter is estimated for each condition. What if instead we wanted to examine the average time course of the activity after the onset of the condition? This method is known as a finite impulse response, or FIR model, in which you specify the length of the time window and how many time points you want to estimate. Instead of estimating the average amplitude of the entire bold response, you estimate the average activity at each time point. For example, if you want to estimate the activity for a condition across a 16-second window every 2 seconds, this would generate 8 beta estimates. You could then compare the activity between or within conditions at certain time points, instead of the overall amplitude of the condition. The advantage of a finite impulse response analysis is that it is not biased toward a particular shape, as is the case with the hemodynamic response function. Instead, the shape is unconstrained, which means that the individual time points can be any value. Even if the shapes aren't that different from the canonical hemodynamic response function, a finite impulse response analysis can be useful in determining aspects of the response, such as the latency in the rise of the bold signal. For example, if we are looking at the bold response to auditory and visual stimuli within the superior temporal gyrus, the overall amplitude of the bold response to the auditory stimuli is greater compared to the visual stimuli, a predictable effect that would be captured by an analysis using the canonical HRF. But that is not all. With a finite impulse response analysis, we can see that the rise in the bold response occurs earlier for the auditory stimuli than it does for the visual stimuli. This more subtle difference between the conditions would be missed if we used a fixed, stereotyped response function for the bold signal. The disadvantage, however, is that the analysis can be less powerful. fMRI data is very noisy, and trying to divide it even further into single time points may lead nowhere. At that scale, it is even easier to overfit the data and model noise instead of the signal. Group analyses can also be more complicated, as you will ideally want to select a single time point or subset of time points. The more time points you analyze at the group level, the more tests you will need to control for. For this tutorial, we will be using the data from the Pauly et al. 2016 paper, and the link can be found in the more info box down below. We will learn how to analyze this dataset in the 3 major fMRI analysis packages: AFNI, FSL, and SPM. The following tutorials assume that you're already familiar with the basics of these packages, which will not be reviewed here. You can access the walkthroughs in the links down below. Fortunately, pre-processing the data for an FIR analysis is identical to the walkthroughs. It is only the statistical modeling that is different. In the next video, we will see how to do this in AFNI.